If the people who I'm talking about see this, I'll be like, hey guys, I'm so glad you're still watching my videos, number one fan. I just held up the number two because I'm dumb, but anyways. I've seen this road a thousand times. I've got no roots, but my home was never on the ground. I've got no roots, but my home was never on the ground. So, have you guys noticed that I got a new camera? HD, finally! Not using my iPhone anymore, I'm so excited. Okay, so anyways, right off the bat, I just want to clarify and tell you guys who this is about so that you don't make assumptions, because every time I make one of these videos, people are like, this is about so-and-so, you're throwing shade, and it's like, dude, I just want to have fun and live my life, so not everything's about someone. This is for all those people that every equine YouTuber has seen on their channel, probably. These types of people come on your videos and they're trying to like, you're abusing your horse for this reason, that reason, or the other reason, and usually they're really stupid reasons that they should not even be upset about. So these people are everywhere. Like, I'd be shocked if there's any YouTuber who has a channel that is even like decently popular where they don't get one of these comments. These people are everywhere and they come onto your channel with this tone of condescension and they're so self-righteous, and this is for them. So shout out to you guys. Like, I get you all the time and your comments, they're pretty funny. You guys are creative, so I'll give you that. Anyways, I want to talk about activism and what that actually is. So to start, I want to talk to the people who comment on my racing videos and are anti-racing and tell me that I'm an abuser and I should be ashamed of myself and blah 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 blah. So first of all, I just wanted to clear this up and say no, I'm not ashamed of myself, because my part in being in the racing industry is riding these horses and being a sympathetic rider and looking out for them and making sure they feel okay, letting the trainer know, and helping to rehome them to meaningful homes. And all of the horses that I've helped rehome from there, I still know where they are, and I actually follow a lot of the owners and see how they're doing, and I love that. And I actually look for homes that I feel like these horses will be well cared for and loved in. So personally, I think I'm doing something for the racing industry by doing that, but I don't really understand why people comment on my videos and dedicate the time to writing literal paragraphs or numerous comments to tell me how awful I am. And I'm just one person. I am a meager exercise rider who has virtually no impact on the racing industry other than on the particular horses who I ride, who would be getting exercised and ridden regardless of whether or not I'm there. Targeting me and trying to shame me and act like you're the better person for recognizing... Oh, hi, Scout LaRue. You can't go up there, I'm sorry. So targeting me when I have virtually no impact on the racing industry other than the horses that I ride is pretty stupid, when you could be dedicating your time to contacting the jockey club, contacting the top trainers, contacting your local racetrack with your concerns, and actually voicing an opinion where it will be heard by someone who actually has say and can do something, more so than what I'm doing. I'm doing what I can in my job, in being the best I can be in my job and helping find these horses homes, and supporting a trainer who follows the values that I have as well and who treats their horses in a manner that I'm comfortable with. So personally, I don't think I should feel guilty, but maybe you should if you're sitting here typing on your keyboard like a little keyboard warrior, being like, hey, I'm doing something by telling this girl off even though it doesn't do anything to help these poor abused horses that I don't think about until I open my computer and put on my little anonymous internet user mask to write these things and feel like a big tough guy. That really bothers me, because these people seem to think that they're animal activists commenting on videos and just doing this whole slamming each other thing. It's not helping anyone. You're not an activist. So I just wanted to make this video because I wanted to talk about this, because people are trying to excuse bullying as animal activism, or just being like, not necessarily a bully, just being a mean-spirited, out-of-control whack job in how you talk to people online, and they try to excuse that as activism. And I just wanted to make the point in saying that even in real cases of abuse where someone has clearly mistreated a horse, or it's like starving to death and completely neglected, if you come at them and you're like, you're wrong, you're such an abuser, you dirt person, you piece of dirt, you're the worst person ever, you should never have animals, you're not likely to get the horse out of there and actually put them in a place where they can be helped without actually going the full legal route, because if you come at someone like that, they're not going to be likely to sell you the horse.
So speaking from my experience of talking to people who run rescues and knowing how they have to handle it when they don't have legal grounds to remove the horse from the property forcibly, they have to use tact and talk to these people like they're equals and be nicer than they should be while they're trying to remove the horse, and then they can do whatever they want when they get the horse away. So even in cases of actual abuse, coming at someone in that manner isn't even remotely helpful to horses. And I also wanted to talk about the fact that as an actual animal activist, it is your job to make sure your information is correct and to make sure you're educated and that you know what you're talking about. So if you're coming at someone with your opinion and you can't source any of it or back any of it up, then you're not an animal activist because you don't care enough about the animals to actually make sure you know what you're talking about so that you can hopefully teach people how to be better animal owners. So it's just laziness, and it's an excuse for being a really crappy person and just making fun of other people, and I hate that. I want to promote real activism and have people actually go out and do things, and it drives me right up the wall that people are trying to target me and pick apart my riding when meanwhile they're likely doing absolutely nothing, and even if they're donating and adopting animals, which I doubt, they're not typing in an educational manner or talking in a manner where people are likely to hear them out and listen. Even from a psychological standpoint, if you come at someone and you're really condescending and nasty, they're not as likely to take what you're saying to heart and actually learn from it. This is why your teachers don't run over to you and be like, you piece of shit, you're blah 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 blah, you're the worst student ever, you're abusing that paper, because that's not how people learn. What I wanted to say to these animal activists is that if you're actually invested in helping animals, you should try to change the tone in which you speak or type, because you're too scared to do it in person, so that it actually helps. Like, if you're actually invested in helping animals, then you shouldn't let your ego bubble over and cause you to spew mean words to people who aren't going to listen to you because you just look like an out-of-control lunatic. So anyways, from my standpoint here, I would consider myself an animal activist. I might not follow everyone's viewpoints or ideals, but that's not the point of animal activism. Animal activism isn't getting mad at everyone who doesn't follow exactly the way you do things or what you view to be correct. Like, personally, I don't like twisted wire bits or bits with abrasive mouthpieces, but you don't see me going on people's videos and tearing them apart for using these, because at the end of the day, if they're not riding with super rough or harsh hands, it doesn't really matter. And even if they are, it's not the worst thing that is going on out there. There's so many worse things that I can actually do something about, because you can't force an owner to change their bit. There's no law saying that they have to ride in a certain bit or that bitless is better, blah 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 blah. So since you have no legal grounds to go after someone like that, and since there's virtually nothing you can do for them other than educate them on why they should change their ways, there's no point in being rude to them. If you're actually invested in educating people, then you need to be like, hey, look, I personally disagree with your bit choice, and this is why. Here's the sources I have to back this, and I really would encourage you to maybe think about using this, or work your way up to using something lighter. You know, something you gotta play the game and kind of give people the benefit of the doubt and actually try to teach them a thing or two, and then maybe you'll actually change something. So yeah, I just wanted to clarify that animal activism isn't just going after anyone who doesn't exactly follow your rhetoric, because that isn't fair, and that's kind of taking it to such an extreme where you're unlikely to actually be taken seriously, and it ruins all your credibility that you might have had. It's really important that we're tactful in how we go about talking to people, and that you learn to pick your battles and not just pick apart everything you don't like about something, and actually ask yourself, is this really abuse? Like, do I have a reason to be this upset about this? Or should I relax and maybe not say anything? Like, is it worth it? Or I should come back when I'm calmer and can type a coherent thought. This is why I take so much time in my educational videos, or whatever you want to call them, about like what I've done with bits and the racing industry or turnout. I take hours trying to compile a list of sources so that people can fact check and read further into things so that they're not just listening to me, because I know I am just an equine YouTuber that people might not necessarily care about. And I also make an effort not to be super condescending or inflammatory in how I make those videos, which is why I'm not yelling or swearing or telling people that they suck and stuff, because it's not worth it, and I don't want people to feel like it's an attack. I want them to feel like I'm bringing information to the table and being like, okay, this is what I think. Here are my points to back this, and I'm just going to leave this here, and you can do whatever you want with it, basically. I just think it's really important that people rethink how they frame things and how they go about their activism, because if you actually care about these animals, you need to frame your points in a manner where they're most likely to be listened to. And if you're really inflammatory and mean, you're not as likely to get the point across in the same way as you could if you stated it calmly and had all the means you needed to back the point, or if you're just honest about it just being an opinion. And this is a huge problem I have with social media, because people use it to be a lot nastier and over the top than they would be in person. And honestly, a lot of the comments I get that people are like, oh, no offense, but, or not trying to be mean, but, or I'm just looking out for your horse, but it's not just looking out for my horse, because it's tearing something completely apart and just blowing it so over the top that it's just unnecessary and ridiculous. I'm sure we've all put things across in a more aggressive manner than we mean to sometimes, and especially when you're targeting specific people, you need to try and make it not come off across as much of an attack if you actually want them to listen to you. And if you're truly looking out for the best interests of the animals, then you need to really care about doing this, because if you actually are an animal activist, then the only focus should be the animal. And if the only focus is your animal and you don't have the means to actually physically remove the animal from the property legally or do something where you can force the person to put the animal in a better situation, then you need to be really careful how you word things, because the purposes then are educational. And if you're trying to educate someone and want them to take your advice, you can't be a dick about it. And I totally get that this whole attitude towards animal activism is promoted by certain groups. Like, I don't think PETA goes about animal activism in a very professional way, and oftentimes they actually are producing false information. So people who follow them typically won't come across the same way as people who fact check everything and look into what organizations are really supporting. And also, there's certain YouTubers, even if they're like 60 years old, who are really condescending and nasty in how they go about their activism. And if people are modeling that as their idols, then I can totally see why they're coming across in an unnecessarily rude way. I think that we need to keep that in mind and really consider what our true intentions are, because if you're just looking to bully people under the guise of being an animal activist, then you need to be honest with yourself and have a look at yourself and stop using a movement that should be positive and should be for the best interests of animals for your own selfish reasons, because that's really not cool. And personally, I wanted to say what I'm doing in my day-to-day life other than producing YouTube videos with my opinions backed with some sources for my animal activism. I've adopted two animals from the SPCA, Milo and my cat, who I'll show in a second. I also frequently donate to the SPCA, and I'm super vocal about encouraging people to adopt. And I've actually had some people come to me and say that they've either considered adopting or actually have gone through and adopted because of what I've said and me sharing my story. So I do think that some things that I've said have had positive benefits on people, and that's what I want to do with my platforms and in promoting animal activism. Another thing that I wanted to point out, and if the people who I'm talking about see this, I'll be like, hey guys, I'm so glad you're still watching my videos, number one fan. I just held up the number two because I'm dumb, but anyways. Some of these people who are really vocal and condescending about animal activism, specifically the anti-bit people who are telling me that I'm abusing my horse for riding in a rubber snaffle, all of them either have no videos of their riding at all, or the ones who do. Like, I went to look at one particular profile who was calling me an abuser and saying I don't care about my horses because I ride in a bit instead of bitless. I went to look at their profile and they were riding around on a lame horse. So I think that kind of shows where these people's values lie and how skewed their judgment can be of others. But then when you look at them, they're imperfect and they're doing things that most people would clearly not be okay with. Or the last thing I want to say is that putting people on blast instead of trying to talk to them and trying to educate them on things you might not agree on, that's not the right thing to do, especially when you're posting their videos of what they might have done wrong or just being really mean to them. Like, these horrible horsemanship accounts or bad equestrians accounts, some of them are just posting videos of riders having moments where their horse might have bolted forward or where they might have made a mistake and accidentally caught their horse in the mouth or something. And these photos look bad, but the person is getting absolutely torn apart for them and having their whole riding judged off of this one moment when it's not an accurate judge of how they really ride. So I think we need to be careful, because I feel like a lot of people are pretending to use their care for animals and their concern for animal abuse as a cover for their want to bully other people. So, this is Scout LaRue, who I adopted. She doesn't want to be in the video now. This is Scout LaRue, who I adopted from the SPCA about 2 years ago. It'll be 2 years in February. She's a tortoise shell kitty. We don't know what her actual breeding is. Look at the camera. I adopted her from the SDCA when she was a baby, and she came all the way from the interior of BC. I adopted her off of a photo, and she's been my best friend ever since. She's very interested in the camera. So anyways, I've had Scout for 2 years as of February. I adopted her February 5th, I think, is when she arrived. And she's honestly the best cat. She is so sweet. She's never done anything mean, never hissed at anyone, never bit, never scratched, nothing. Like, she is the most mild-mannered, sweet animal ever. And I love her. Like, she's the best. And of course, as you all know, Milo's also from the SPCA. I adopted him about 3.5 years ago now. And he is also the best. And I just wanted to make a point in saying that the adoption fees from animal organizations that rescue them, they're so low for what you're getting. Like, Scout was $150, and she was spayed, had her first and second round of shots, and she was microchipped and tattooed, all for $150. And I really don't think I could have gotten all of that for cheaper, even if I'd gotten a cat for free from like a farm or something. So that was really cheap. And then Milo was $400, which basically just covers what they paid to geld him and not all the food that they funneled into him to make him look more presentable than he was when he came in. These fees are really, really cheap, and you're getting really nice animals for these fees. I would definitely encourage adopting, and if you want to be an animal activist, that's a really good place to start, is considering adopting. And I'm not saying that you have to adopt and that buying from breeders is bad, but I think that if you are going to buy from a breeder, you should make sure it's a reputable breeder. And I also think that adopting should be something that everyone takes into serious consideration when they're looking for an animal. I also have some designs in my store where partial proceeds are going to animal organizations that rescue and rehab animals. Right now, the main one is the BCSPCA, which is where I got Scout and Milo from, and that's why I selected it. But I'm always open to making more designs and donating to other organizations. So if anyone has any suggestions of where they'd like some of the proceeds to go from these designs, please let me know and I'll add them to my store. And I'll put the link in my down below description so that you guys can check out the design that I have currently where the proceeds are being donated to the SPCA. And the last thing I just wanted to say is that obviously being online and trying to educate people when you actually are is great, but at the end of the day, you're gonna get more done if you contact big organizations that are in charge of these things. My point basically just is that picking apart the little guys only does so much, and your best bet with people who don't really have a whole lot of say in terms of how things are done is trying to educate them. And then when you want to actually pick apart specific things and want laws put in place, you need to contact the big guys who handle all the money and who are the rule makers of any given organization.